So what do we have this week?
This week we have drones, as always. We have Adobe putting out all sorts of fun stuff. And let's see, what else I got here? I got a 24-karat Nikon DF.
Let's focus on that.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Aperture Cat. I'm Ryan.
And I'm Tom.
And this is our first story. In the giant blizzard that was Buffalo this past week or so, photographer for the Buffalo News, Derek Gee, who happened to have a DJI Phantom around equipped with a GoPro, decided to apparently shovel himself with a nice GoPro-equipped drone-sized hole in his garage snowbank and circle the neighborhood shooting the 6 feet of snow all his neighbors were shoveling out of. That's the idea of being stuck in a house and just kind of remoting a drone out the window is...
That was great to watch because he was actually doing it while the snow was still falling. You saw the video, right?
I have actually seen the video. I saw
the video was great. It's actually while the snow was still falling, so like he has to actually bring it back and wipe the lens off and send it back out again at one point. But he's out flying it around his neighborhood and you know, he goes up and you can see he goes over the trees and it comes around and you can just see... It just everything just looks like flat white because you know you have the clouds up top, so you know it's all diffuse light, and everything's just white. And from the further up you go, the more flat everything looks because everything is covered in snow.
Snow, which is by this point completely gone because it was 6 degrees raining.
Yeah, and they actually had some pretty serious flooding.
That's gotta be scary.
Oh yeah.
So he submitted this as part of his work for the Buffalo News. So I think they host little pictures, so it should be easy enough to find.
Oh yeah,
Buffalo drone snow phantom something.
Oh yeah, they'll be pretty easy to find. Sticking with the drone thing, because we like drones, and you notice we always either start with drones or with space. That just seems to be the recurring theme. The FAA is actually reporting they're having a lot of trouble with drones at airports.
Yeah,
a lot of close calls, and this is actually kind of frightening when you think about the fact that I get in planes all the time for work and. The commercial pilots, like 757, 737 pilots, are getting freaked out by drones near the airport. So, apparently, there were, up to this point in the year, in 2014, there have been 175 incidents of drones near airports and 25 near collisions.
Which, near collision for a plane is varying, but...
But, I mean, they had to have been able to see it, which if you're in a cockpit...
You can see those commercial lights pretty far off. You can see those lights for a quarter mile.
You can see the lights.
I think people would get a wrong descriptor of how close what an incident would be, and then how close what a near collision would be, because a near collision to an aircraft is a long way.
That's true.
But it's still very scary, and it's still one of those things that needs to be regulated better, obviously, and not that it's already not regulated. It's obviously very, very illegal. And these people deserve what they get for doing what they're doing.
Yeah, they definitely deserve it. The reason this comes up though is that DJI, you know, make the Phantom and make you know the biggest manufacturer of this, they don't have a very specific like thing in the firmware that says you know it can't go over 400 feet or it can't go within these zones, even though they very well could, because they feel that it should be up to the operator to be responsible for it.
The moment you start doing that, it's a whole another can of worms to
exactly. I mean.
It's not everywhere that 400 feet is the ceiling, so there's certain permits and different things you need to do to make...
Well, 400 feet above the ground is the ceiling for RC aircraft.
Yeah, which you can, if you're not in the U.S., is different. If you're not in, you know, which is a lot of the use of these things, apparently, because the FCC is fun.
I mean, imagine if your car was locked down to 55 miles an hour.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think there'd be too many people happy about that.
No.
I know my trip back from Maryland and Philadelphia would have been much, much longer.
It's interesting. It's just like anything. It needs to be enforced properly, and the law has to actually be written.
Yeah,
and it has to be brought up again and reinforced again. The rules around these things, the rules right now are so gray area for other parts of the use of these things that this particular part suffers for it. If you regulate the whole thing properly, then this will be less of an issue.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, don't fly drones near airports.
Yeah, don't go near airports. Unless you're in Mexico, apparently. That one really cool video of the guy who flew the drone over because Mexico has no law against it.
Yeah, that makes it better.
That But it was a really cool video of watching planes taxi around and stuff. But I could only imagine being a pilot when that was being shot. That would be absolutely frightening.
So, this is a fun discussion, given the cameras we shoot on.
Oh, I meant to print these out and make them full size, but it's not
worth it. That's easier to see online. So, another video, also saying the same thing as 10 other videos, but this time very specifically, does 6 times the price in gear get you 6 times the photo?
I got a spoiler for this one. No.
Apparently. So, there's two photos side by side. They're both taken through the SLR lounge, that group of photographers, group of journalists in the photography field. They took a Canon 5D Mark III and an 85mm F12L, which is $5,400 worth of gear, and took a shot directly next to a Canon Rebel T5i with the 85 1.8, which is $600, $800 worth of gear. And they posted the straight out of camera JPEGs online to show you the side-by-side real actual world use of the two images.
Yeah.
And you can barely tell the difference.
Yeah, when you, especially when you scale it down to what you would see on Facebook.
Yeah, the web. I mean, the web scaling. The web scaling and anything else.
It's so close. It's one of those proof that the camera doesn't make the photographer.
Mm-hmm.
But they do point out that if you have the raw files, because the 5D Mark III's raw file is much nicer, you have more pixels to work with, you have better editing control. But in a daylight situation with comparable gear at totally different price points, not in that, you know, a 1.2L is the same as a 1.8, you know, standard issue. But when you set them both at like f/2.8, and so you're not doing anything crazy, you can compose the same picture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the whole point, is the composition is exactly the same. The look of it is very similar. Yes, the bokeh is a little bit nicer with the L lens. It's going to be. It's nicer glass. It's got more aperture blades. But is the photo significantly different? I'm looking at these two and going, not really.
So
I mean, there's a little bit of field of view difference for the full frame.
The whole point of this argument is a lot of the discussion about gear is tailored to people who actually don't need to actually talk about gear in that sort of way.
Yeah.
The difference between these two pictures for 90% of people who own a camera is nothing. These pictures are both the same picture, whether you spent thousands and thousands of dollars or not thousands and thousands of dollars. Because you're not publishing this picture, or if you are publishing this picture, it's not in a fashion that requires a huge raw file to be transmitted in a special way to your publisher or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
When you're actually working commercial work, the range in which the camera will still operate at its max gets much bigger, and the quality at its top of the line is much better.
Yeah.
But when you're not shooting for that end, the difference is not there. It just doesn't matter.
Yeah, exactly.
Like I know if I was going to look at these two pictures in full raw, I would have a hard time using pictures from the T5i because of the way I've seen my photos change over the years and what I want out of photos.
Yeah, but you're looking for very specific things than you're putting out pictures to print. You're doing your wedding photographer thing where you're looking for every single little detail, whereas the whole point of this comparison and this article is that for the guy taking pictures to post on Facebook of his vacation, do you need the 5D Mark III and the 7200 and all this?
No.
Which drives me nuts when I see people walking around like that. It wouldn't bother me. This just bugs me from, this was 2 summers ago. I was walking around down in Patuxent Village. There was a guy down there, and it was a 5D Mark II. And you know, the 7200, and he had like another bag on him with like, obviously he was all top of the line gear. You know, I'm a photographer. I like gear. I like to talk to people. Okay, I don't really like to talk to people, but I wanted to talk to this guy because he had really nice stuff. And I have, you know, this was before I bought my 6, so I still had my Rebel on me. And I go down and I talk to the guy, and I'm like, hey, you know, that's a really nice camera. You know, I've been a photographer myself. I'm trying to strike up conversations. Like, yeah, I don't know what the hell it is. It takes pictures. I'm like, okay, I just want to point out, and I actually told this to the guys, I just want to point out, that lens alone is more than my entire collection of gear. At least I know what I'm doing with it.
It's one of those things, you get the people who say that intentionally just to sound like they're kind of pompous when they say it. There's people who mean it, there's people that don't mean it.
Yeah.
There's people who actually don't know how to work a camera, but they want something that takes really good pictures. And then there's people who, they've been taking pictures for so long, it doesn't matter.
Right.
And that's, I've met those photographers, especially in journalism settings, where it's like, they'll never have new gear. They'll use something until it dies and it breaks and you fix it again and they have another one that dies. If you see a journalist with something past like a D2H and a Nikon D2X or a 1D whatever, 1D flat,
yeah.
They're it's very rare because the gear they use is so beat and so used so hard, they don't care. It still takes a good picture. It still does what they want to do, and that's all that matters. I remember that back when I was in college with a D90 shooting next to somebody for the Herald, Fall River. He was in D2Xs and D2S, and it's the D90 is doing stuff the D2S won't, but the D2S is still going to work every single time he pulls it out the same way that it's ever always worked, and that's all that matters.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I mean, and a big part of what you're paying in the 1 series in Canon is that durability.
Oh, yeah, the same thing with the Nikon series.
I've talked to Moose, my fraternity brother, who is a photojournalist. He covers sports out in Wyoming. We've talked about him before, and he's got his two 1D, one's a 1DX, one's a first edition 1D, and he's like, I just throw them back. I don't care. Because when I pull them out, they're going to work.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm just like, okay.
I've seen the same thing.
And in his case, there's a good chance a bull could, knock that out of his hands because he's shooting rodeos. Well, probably not that good a chance. He's not getting that close, but it's always a possibility. So.
Yeah, I'm interested in that myself as a duffel bag. Like, that's...
Yeah.
You're not going to get your stuff stolen that way. You're not going to get people rummaging through a bag that looks like a gym bag.
Yeah.
But I would never do that with my gear. My gear is not built for that.
Yeah.
Maybe the 600 is not built that way.
No.
It takes fantastic pictures for the money, but it's not going to take a duffel bag. No.
Yeah. So, anyway, same thing we've been saying forever and ever. The gear doesn't matter until it matters. And so, that's that.
Yeah.
We're beating a dead horse, but it's just a topic we like to bring up once in a while to remind people that although there's all these podcasts out here and people are always talking about the newest and best gear, you don't always need the newest and best gear.
So, not at all.
All right. Speaking of the newest and best gear.
You get to read this one.
Well, okay, the newest gear. Sony has announced the A7 II. Not the Mark II. There's no Mark. They're not trying to be pompous like Canon, which I love my marks. The A7 II. It's the very first one with 5-axis image stabilization in body.
Yay.
Well, what it means is they can make less expensive lenses. They aren't putting the optical stabilization in the lenses. They're putting it in the body. But it also will work with lenses that have stabilization, they claim.
I'm dubious of how well that works.
I would just turn it off.
Well, yeah, the body stuff, the idea that it will use them both is kind of...
I'm not sure how that would work.
I find that a little weird. I'd be amazed to see it actually work.
But it's a 24 megapixel. It's not really... The actual sensor is no different than the A7, the original A7.
Which it doesn't need to be.
It doesn't need to be. It's got a little bit faster processor, but it's got the in-body stabilization, so it can do yaw, tilt, pan, zoom, turn, whatever. All the different ways you could ever wrangle a camera. It's capable. I mean, obviously, if you're going like this, it's not going to work. But, I mean, for anything else. And it claims 4.5 stops of stabilization, which is pretty damn impressive.
Yeah.
But I guess you can get that because you're closer to the focal point, the access point. It does have the articulated screen on the back. It does all the... It's basically the same thing. It's a little bit faster processor. So and it's coming out at $1,600 in January. That's one thing I like about Sony. When they announce something, it's coming out.
Yeah, it's coming out quick. And they have the money to put stuff down range very quickly.
Yeah.
Like any new product is very quickly put in the market. I like the grip is a little different, and the record button on the grip.
Yeah.
The video record for hybrid shooting.
Yeah, it's
being right on the thumb grip is very cool. And I think that's one of the biggest upgrades over the first A7 is a little bit more grip. Honestly,
it's a little bit bigger grip, yeah, because it was a little too small.
They're trying to show off by making it really, really thin, but when you're trying to shoot,
I think they got
feedback
that said, really thin is nice, but I need to be able to hold it in my hand without feeling like it's going to fall out. So they had to put a little bit back. The other thing they did is they changed the E-mount. It's now a fully metallic E-mount, so it's stronger.
Yeah,
that's before it was a hybrid of metal and plastic, and it did. it worked just fine, but if you put a really heavy lens on the end...
They're developing bigger and bigger lenses, so you need to...
Yeah, exactly.
Need to make that
so work. As they make bigger lenses, they needed to reinforce the mount, so they've done that with this, and that'll be going forward, hopefully. So...
Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
So to continue with lighter and lighter applications for photos, Adobe has Photoshop running natively in Chrome, the web browser, not the UI. Chrome is also an operating system. Browser, they have it running.
Yes.
So what it found out back in September, Adobe is working with Google to make a Photoshop streaming service, which will stream Photoshop editing through Google Chrome to edit. Right now, it's only photos that are in your Google Drive account, but in the future, other streams, cloud service storage.
That looks really interesting because it's basically running a full version of Photoshop on the server, and you're just sending commands back and forth to it. Basically, we've come full circle. That's how mainframes used to work.
Yeah. It's interesting. I can't wait to see, especially the mobile. The mobile application is really the whole point of this.
Yeah. When this gets to running on a tablet properly, although I'm still going to want my Surface Pro 3 with full Photoshop right there on it, but that's me.
I'll take one of those, too. They seem to be giving out as many of those as humanly possible. We should probably work on that.
They're everywhere. Yeah.
They're everywhere. Their marketing for the Surface Pro 3s is funny, funny, funny. They've been just giving them to everybody.
We need to get some of these.
Yeah, we should. They're probably in the dumpsters at like news agency at this point. During the election coverage, they were like propping iPads on them because they have them. The marketing, they have them on all of the desks, the Surface Pro 3s, and the first thing any reporter was doing was iPad on top of it, and it's like it's just the saddest thing to see.
Well, I loved when the NFL has the deal with Microsoft for all the services, and I guess the guys from Sunday Night Football and NBC got into a ton of trouble because they kept calling them iPads.
Oh yeah.
And they got yelled at. They're like, dude, you can't call it an iPad. It's a Surface. You have to call it the right thing. It's a sponsor.
Side note.
That wasn't a side note enough.
Samsung has been... have you seen the ads with the Samsung tech with the newlywed couple who is pregnant with the actor from Idiocracy and... I forget his name.
No, I think I missed this one.
So YouTube ads. The ad is very long. It's very fun. And it's a couple. It's just the two of them. They're expecting a baby. And they both have like every piece of Samsung gear. And they just kind of interact in fun, like a relationship stuff.
All right.
And, like, the most recent one, he's putting up Christmas lights. He's doing what they're doing on the Christmas decorations. And they're very... They stay in line of long ads that are fun and engaging that make you watch them for 5 minutes.
Yep.
There
are a number of those on YouTube, and I get stuck watching.
They put the money downrange for actors. They put some very good actors into this. Actors I actually like in other movies.
Yep.
And they're having so much fun with all of their Samsung gear. It's really good advertising. Comedy Central is fun too. They just put episodes of Key and Peele as ads. They just do whole clips, like the finger nose thing. They just put that whole 5 minute clip as an ad on YouTube. What's the thing? In the meantime, like, I want to go watch this video. You just get stuff you want to watch in between.
This is great.
They're paying for you to watch their stuff you've already seen, but it's good anyway.
Somebody is finally figuring out how to do internet advertising right.
Well, advertising, I don't know how effective that really is, because advertising to somebody who already likes your stuff is kind of weird. I get it, but anyway, I find that really funny that they're trying to make ads that make you sit and watch them for 5 minutes. It's just making TV again.
Yep.
It's just another... Ads are just going to be different shows that you're forced to watch in between other shows.
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
It already is.
Because when you do it that way, it doesn't feel like it's an ad.
No, I love watching YouTube ads now.
Hi, Elliot.
Cat!
Hi, Cat. Cat went on a road trip with me.
Mm.
So, I'm going to bring up drones again because I forgot to bring this up before. So, we had to go down to New York and Philly and down to Maryland and back up this past week. And Cat came with me because I didn't want to leave him here by himself for the week. Although I left him here by himself for the 2 weeks prior.
Yeah, that was fun.
Well, I left him with you.
Thanks.
Hey, he takes care of himself.
Sure he does.
But as we were going down, I hit dead stop traffic on 95 South. And I even tweeted this because I was in park, so I didn't feel bad about using my phone while I was in traffic. Because we were parked. And I was like, wish I had a drone so I could see what the hell was going on. there's your first use for one of those little pocket camera drones that looks like they have absolutely no use in life. I'd be like, no, I just take that out, charge it up in my cigarette lighter because it charged off USB, and you go see what the accident was, come back, land, be all set. Go right out the sunroof in the car. And...
That'd be good.
So I found a use for that thing. I found a use for it.
Yep, as soon as it doesn't suck.
Speaking
of Adobe working on their software, Lightroom 5.7 is out, and it features Aperture Importer and support for the latest cameras. People actually use Aperture. I don't. We'll be excited to know that you can now import your Aperture more easily and more without hitches.
I feel like this is too little too late to the party.
Probably.
Because I feel like most of the people who were using Aperture...
went away with the last Mac update and all that kind of stuff.
Well, when it went away with the last Mac update, they already migrated everything with the external tool that Adobe supplied. All they did was build it in, but all the people who needed it already moved it. I feel like. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe some people... No, these are Mac users. They'll hold out forever. There'll be people using Aperture 10 years from now with the no updates. But it's just one of those things. I'm like, you guys already do this.
It's nice to see. I recently updated the CC too, so seeing the update is nice. The D600 never worked on 4.
Yep.
And I owned 4 for a while. So eventually I said, damn it, I want to import and tether my damn camera that I paid a bunch of money for and they never supported because it was discontinued immediately. I'm happy to see 5.7 and happy to know that my camera actually imports.
Your camera's imported fine since 5.0.
I meant tethered. It never tethered in 4.
No.
Never tethered in
4. But we always say that it's my computer, because I bought 5 right off the bat.
I know. Just it says it's supported in 4. It was supported in 4 a month after the camera came out. Never was actually supported.
No, never really worked great.
So that was fun.
But you get the updated
camera. Yeah, it's a 7.5. It's camera raw, the D750, the 770 Mark II, X100T Fuji, X1T T1.
Basically, if it came out in the last 2 months, it works in Lightroom and camera raw now.
Better tethering for the D4S and 810, finally. Yep.
Finally.
Seems like a while.
The 810 one, I'm surprised it took this long because the 810 has been out. Well, not the 810, the 800 has been out for a while. So
yeah, the 810 has been out. Not too long. Lenses, all that sort of stuff, just a good update. Normal Lightroom update. This one I actually saw when it first happened. A few people, Patrick Lundoff and Kristen Steinrunker, yay, 3D printed.
It's got an umlaut on it. Yeah, that's why he's having a hard time with it.
They 3D printed a filter holder for the 14-24 f/2.8 Nikon lens.
And the reason I put this in here is because I know you want that lens.
Oh, I need that lens. And in the process of needing that lens, I have seen how much the filter holders are. They're not, you can spend whatever amount of money you would like to on a filter holder. They have these
rules. You can spend nothing and just use your hand.
It's very, very difficult with that
lens.
Yes,
it is.
That lens is.
It is.
People say that in the comments. Like, just use your hand. I don't like touching my camera to shutter to release the shutter. If the shutter going up and down in my camera is making my pictures blurry, holding the filter against the front of the lens is probably the stupidest thing you could do.
I'm just saying.
The amount of money you willing to spend. Like, you could just hold the filter. And I see somebody holding a filter against the front of the lens while using a shutter release. And one of these things causes you to touch the camera and the other doesn't. I just don't understand how that works. But through a process of a couple of experimentation and trial and error, they 3D printed a one-piece plastic holder with foam rubber on the inside, so it just kind of pressure fits to the bayonet mount, and just allows you to use 250mm square glass filters. So there are other filter holders that let you use bigger and smaller holders, different number of filters in the process. This one, being cheap, especially, is a nice thing. A cheap filter holder for a $2,000 lens seems like a fun... I don't fully understand why the cheaper thing mattered. Making it better is nice. I like the whole thing that it's better. I don't know if I like the fact that it's only pressure fit. There are some that do lock in a little bit and then you screw on, which I think I would prefer more because it will never fall off. But for a good solution to try that's relatively cheap, that would probably be worth trying.
Yeah, I mean, $125 is relatively cheap when you're talking about a $2,000.
Yeah, I mean, the other one's between $150 and $200. If you don't know why, the 14 and 24 2.8, it's a very bulbous front end with no ability to use any sort of threaded filters. So you have to use flat glass filters, which if you're a landscape photographer, you probably do anyway, if you're that serious about what you do.
Yeah.
a holder for that is a very, very specific thing. As before that lens, you need to have one that connects to the lens in a good, solid way. And it's such a wonky lens, it has to be purpose-built.
Yep.
It's such a good lens, though. Similarly, I'm pretty sure we're talking about something similar in another sort of thing. For you.
Well, yeah. But before we get to that, Nikon in Japan.
I love these.
This is great.
I love these. I want them so bad.
Nikon Japan has announced a limited edition gold adorned version of the black Nikon DF.
It's black and gold. It's
black and gold, still so black cool. And silver, but the gold is all 24 karat gold, so it's really it's, pretty.
In contrast to the one that he was talking about earlier, which is a $41,000 solid gold plated camera, this is a very reasonable black and gold collector's edition sort of camera that is only $2,685 or $2,870 with the kit lens, which is a 50mm 1.8.
Which also is
specially gold ringed and cool looking.
Yeah. No, it actually looks really cool. And actually, I like the look of this better than the regular black DF.
I do too.
And it comes with the special edition strap, which doesn't have the yellow edge on the end of it. Hey, if they're going to go, they're going to go all out.
It's a pretty camera. It may as well have a strap that matches it.
Exactly. They went all out with this. It looks great.
So they're making 600 of these that are just body only and another 1,000 which are kits, which is not a lot.
And only selling them in Japan.
I'm sure you could get one.
I'm sure people are going to import them. And the best part is they're claiming price when they release them is actually going to be less than the regular DF. By like $100, which probably means there's a DF price drop.
Oh, of course,
because they wouldn't sell this for more less than they sell the regular.
The DF is one of those cameras I see myself being in the market for once they drop low enough. It's such a good sensor, and such a no frills stills body.
Yep.
It doesn't shoot video, which is the only reason that I have a problem with it.
Yep.
Everything else about the camera is so good. It's still one of like the three or four best low light SLRs in the market.
Oh yeah,
which is hilarious, being the old blocky Nikon body thing that it kicks the shit out of a lot of other cameras. I love the engineering of it's very cool. Having it in your hand is very nice. It's almost too light. That's the only complaint I get from having played with it.
Yep,
it looks like an old film body, and you want it to weigh like a pound,
like more like than an it old is. Film body. Yeah,
it's too magnesium. There's too much magnesium in it.
So, for old film bodies, this is another tangent I'm going to go on. My sister asked me what I wanted for Christmas. I said, you mean a Canon Elon 7? Because it was the last film body they made. Well, I mean, they still make the super high-end ones, but the last, regular commercial film body they made, but it takes the EOS mount.
Mm-hmm.
So I can use all my lenses on it.
How many EOS? Did they not make that many EOS mount? 35s?
No.
Because Nikon's been... There's so many F-mount Nikons. I have like a crappy old F-mount Nikon.
They kept the FD mount on the film bodies all the way up to like the last generation Elons. Because I don't know why.
Yeah.
Because they're Canon.
I love the idea of just picking up...
But I have the FD to EF mount. But no, they didn't put the EF mount on film bodies except for like the very end.
I bought an N70 or something. It's kind of a crappy old Nikon, but it still runs all of the new lenses, which is nice. Yeah.
See, I have the reverse mount. I can put my old lenses on my new camera,
mm.
which I've come to realize isn't worth it.
No, not really. So talk about your damn lens.
I can't. The cat's laying on top of it. You're going to have to talk about it for me. Ow. Uh-huh. I can't get him to talk about Canon even if I try.
Uh-huh.
So there have been rumors going around for a long time about the 11 to 24 millimeter f/4 new L lens from Canon. They've just been rumors, but very well confirmed. They've been very well documented rumors, but it finally showed up on the Canon Germany website for about an hour. And then they took it down properly, but
it was an accident.
It was an accident. They accidentally put it up with a picture and a description. So, obviously, they've built at least a prototype of one of these for there to be, like, a legit picture of it. Oh, it's
more than a prototype.
It's coming out. We all know it's coming out. And I don't read German, so I'm not even going to try and butcher this, but they did have it up, and someone got a screen grab of the image with the description. So, it looks pretty cool. I'm happy because that finally means there's something in that same, you know, you've got a 10 to 14. This is an 11 to 24. I'm excited because I like wide angle lenses.
Well, it's better than the 14 24.
Yeah.
Really.
So it's 11 to 24. It's coming.
It is F4. That's the...
It's F4, not F2.8. But mm-hmm. if you're shooting landscapes, you're not always shooting... You're not shooting a 2.8 anyway.
2.8 on that lens is a lot of depth anyway. So,
yeah.
I still want one. Yeah. I still need one is the worst part. Like, it's not even a matter of... I should really buy one of those. It's...
I really need one of those. Let's see what happens when I pull this out. Hey! The cat stayed still. All right.
So... The crowdfunding is a thing.
This is not only a thing. This is a thing that I want us to do every week now.
Yeah, we can definitely do that.
So we're going to do this.
I'm in the crowdfunding thing.
Ryan is very into the crowdfunding thing.
Not that I've ever really paid people much money for things, but I have. More in the running things.
I've paid lots of money for things.
I've paid cyanide and happiness $15.
I paid 10 times that amount just to get a CD made.
Okay.
I also get to go on one of the tour dates with the band and ride in the van with them.
Okay. Sure.
It's going to be fun.
Sure.
It's going to be fun.
It's fine.
Anyway, so this is something I'd like us to do every week. So if you guys have anything you think should be brought to our attention for this, we're going to do a crowdfunding project of the week. Insert okay. graphic.
So this week, it is a small portable flash cube. Which pumps out 1,500 lumens of power. What is the name of it? Loom Cube.
The Loom Cube.
Loom Cube. Not a bad name.
No.
It's L-U-M-E Cube. Is this on right now? Or is this
it's on right now. On They've right actually, now. I checked it out right before we came on here, and I did update the bottom. They had a goal of $50,000.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier today when I printed these out, they were at $101,000 already.
Very cool.
So this is happening. They still have 2 weeks left. So by the time you guys see this, 10 days left, because I have to edit it still. But you can find them over on Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. You can get a Loom Cube for $59, a two-pack for $99, and it goes up from there. But you can control up to 5 at a time through your phone. That's what makes it work so well, is you can do up to 5 at a time. You can control luminosity on your phone. It charges over USB. It's actually kind of really super ingenious.
Seems pretty straightforward. It's a good battery life. 2 hours at 50% luminosity power. They go up to 7,500 lumens if you use a bunch of them, five of them. But one or two of them is probably a great little accent light or something to kind of give some fill for something like a GoPro, especially a GoPro. It's kind of the whole point is lighting for action cameras and cell phones.
Which is
why it made so much money.
Yep. I mean, that really is the whole point. I mean, I probably wouldn't use it with the DSLR because I can bring a speed light. But
like DSLR video, I'm sure we'll use some of these occasionally.
Oh, yeah.
Especially as little fills and little accent lights, it's a very useful thing.
Or if you need to, like, put lights in a box that were battery operated and, you know.
And roll controllable. Yep. So, yeah, that's our Loom Cube is our Kickstarter of the week. If you have any questions, any comments, feel free to post them in the video description / comment section.
If you've got a project you want us to talk about, send us a link to it. We'll review it, and if we like it, we'll talk about it. And if we really like it, we might try and get you involved. Maybe we'll get you on Skype or something, record it a little bit, and let you talk a little bit about your project.
Yeah, absolutely.
So. I only have one thing that's not on here that I kind of wanted to touch on, just because I finally finished the working on the video,
mm-hmm.
and we got just a couple of minutes left before the camera runs out, mm-hmm. and I'm going to make you sit here and suffer through this.
Go for it.
Last weekend, before I went on the road trip with Elliot here, I returned the Sigma 15mm f2.8 fisheye lens that I had borrowed lenses.
Mm-hmm.
And I just finished up, before we sat down here, working on the review video for that. And so I wanted to get your feeling, because we haven't done the More Money Than Brains Club thing in a while.
Mm-hmm.
I want to get your feelings, and we won't do the whole math and everything. I just kind of want to throw it up there as if we were throwing it on the board for More Money Than Brains. About a 15mm fisheye lens.
I need to see the performance of it, especially. I have a weird thing with, especially third-party fisheye lenses, sucking terribly. I've worked with, like, it was probably one of the worst lenses ever made. It's like a Tokina, like, 12, 10, it's a 10 to 14 fisheye. It's for DX cameras, Nikon mount. It's the one of the worst ones I've ever used in my life. The experience with that thing makes me hate fisheye lenses. Like, almost in general, just hate fisheye lenses.
All
right. I get the use. I understand the photos you want with them. I understand that they're very useful for certain things. For me personally, I almost never would use one, which is why I kind of don't research them. I'm not a huge fan of fisheye lenses as a general rule, but a decent third-party fisheye lens for certain applications like using concerts, I see being perfectly useful.
It was a lot of fun to work with. It actually worked extremely well. It's in the EX series, so it's the same as our 2470s.
Mm-hmm.
It's in that same series. It's got an amazing build quality to it. It's really hefty. Like I expected, but because I used the first time I rented a fisheye, I got the Canon 8-15 f/4 because I wanted the zoom factor on the fisheye. But I realized that just about every shot I took was either 14 or 15 millimeters. So this time I said, you know what? Let me try the Sigma one because it goes to f/2.8. Especially shooting a concert where I need all that extra light. It worked really well. I actually did kind of miss the zoom a little bit because that little bit between 13, 14, 15 millimeters, I kind of missed that. But I definitely didn't miss the f/4 when I was shooting over there. Because I'm already cranking it to 4,000 ISO just to take pictures. But it was really well built. I was very happy with it. If I was shooting anything other than an indoor small concert, I'd prefer the Canon. Just for that more option with the zoom.
Mm-hmm.
But in that low light, that 2.8, 15 millimeter, it worked great. It was beautiful. I couldn't tell you the first thing about chromatic aberration because the lighting is always horrible.
Yeah, it's pink anyway. What difference?
It's pink and orange and green and blue anyway, so you can't count on that. One thing I found really amusing though, as I put it in Lightroom, and there was a lens correction for it.
Yes.
So it goes, and it turns into a big flat image, and I was like, never press that button.
Yeah, that's pretty bad.
It turns into a 15 millimeter wide angle with a whole lot of distortion.
Yeah, there's a lot of fun stuff you can do with wide-angle fisheye lenses. And they're certainly fun to play with. It just, for my kit, I don't see one in it.
See, I definitely, not only would I pick up one of those, I would actually pick up the Sigma one at this point, having used both. The price point, it's a quarter of the price.
Oh, yeah.
It's $600 versus over $2,000. And it's, at 2.8, it was just phenomenal to shoot with. And that little bit of zoom I lost, yeah, it was a pain when I wanted to get a little closer and I didn't have that option, but it has a focal distance of 5.9 inches. So
it's very cool.
It zoomed like a macro lens. I was happy, or focused like a macro lens.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, that'd be a cool video to check out.
Yeah, that'll be
as
up.
Soon as that goes live.
That'll be up later this week. And yeah, that's all I got this week.
Sounds like a good week.
All right. Well, for the sleepy kitty here, who apparently is sleeping for the first time ever, we'll see you next week.
Have a good one.